Returning to the question of population control, the author argues that population is a particularly difficult challenge, where the population uses the commons, which are the resources of the planet. And the reason it's a problem is because we generally hold the value of human life very highly, appropriately so. We support people through all kinds of various relationships, through social structures, through government programs, etc. And yet people use these resources, as people use these resources, they are resources that are held in common. So the author then provides about five different solutions to the general problem of the tragedy of the commons. One is that you can convert the commons into a private asset. So for example, in the case of ocean fishing, you can imagine demarcating out areas of the ocean, selling them as tracts to individuals who are then responsible for managing that. It's no longer a commons, only that individual has rights to that area to fish, and as a result, they're incentivized to manage it so that they will continue to extract profit from it in the long run. In the case of carbon pollution, carbon dioxide pollution, you can create cap and trade markets. Cap and trade markets give people the right to pollute if they have credits to pollute. Those credits can be bought and sold on a market, but you're not allowed to pollute unless you have those credits. So in that way, you've created a market that distributes the resources of the commons rather than enabling everyone to be able to use the commons at once. This, of course, requires regulation and enforcement. A third solution is to use mutual coercion. So this is basically a change in social infrastructure or social morality in order to establish sustainability to a commons. So for example, we don't allow bank robbers to treat our money like commons when they're in a bank. They can't just walk in and say, hey, here's a lot of money. It's just in common. I'm going to take some of that for myself. Instead, we just completely prohibit it. And if we outlaw something like that, we're using the force of legal penalty, the force of state control, to prevent the use of something as a commons. A fourth solution would be to tax things or to treat them as a limited use environment. So for example, for parking spaces on the road, at least in urban environments, these are like a commons. And so in order to prevent it from being overused so that there's parking available when you need it, we tax them in a way with parking meters. We usually put an absolute cap on the amount of parking that can be done by putting a 2-hour, 4-hour limit, maybe an overnight prohibition on parking somewhere. And through this, we establish a proactive economic regulation of something that could otherwise be a commons. A fifth example is through permitting. So if you take, for example, what hunters are allowed to do, they're allowed to buy a permit to go in and hunt, say, deer in a particular area. And the number of permits that are issued limit the amount of access to the wilderness, which is the commons, so that the deer population can continue to exist in some healthy way. Some hunters are allowed to hunt, and in this way, we're selling access to a commons. So those are some solutions. So the problem, though, is that anytime you legislate the commons, you regulate the commons in some way, that's necessarily infringing on someone's personal liberty. If you legislate permits for hunting, hunters are no longer as free as they were. If you put in parking meters, people who park are no longer as free as they were. And if you regulate pollution, manufacturers are no longer as free as they were. So this management of the commons is always going to have someone who's worse off for the benefit of the commons as a whole. So this quote from the article says, to sort of point that out, it says, individuals locked into the freedom of the commons are free only to bring on universal ruin. And this is, of course, only relevant as population grows. Not doing anything to protect a commons isn't a solution, because ultimately the commons will be destroyed as the usage grows. So any solution is going to have problems. And because of that, we know that a solution to the problem of the tragedy of the commons, in that case, the perfect is the enemy of the good. So trying to seek a perfect solution to managing the commons is probably not available. And while you're searching for a perfect solution, the commons may be degraded when a good solution might be sufficient for protecting the commons. If we return to the original question that Hardin introduced about limiting population growth that sparked this whole thinking and this whole analytical process, it's important to recognize that his argument didn't entirely turn out the way he envisioned it. Various studies since 1968 have shown that population growth may actually be in the process of self-correcting. This is because there are other forces at work besides just a real simple market-based mechanism. Population in the industrialized world appears to be leveling off. This, per these predictions here from Nature, the journal Nature, indicate some predictions of how that might be. And this is, it's not sure why, but some proposed causes to why this leveling off has happened include increased education, increased standard of living, increased rights for women, particularly over the access and ability to use birth control, urban lifestyles, secularism, cost of living going up. These are all things that have been proposed as causes for this leveling off of population growth. Irregardless, the idea of the tragedy of the commons remains a very useful and persistent way of, and powerful way of looking at systems in which there is a commons at work. In summary, the commons, if justifiable at all, is justifiable only under conditions of low population density. And of course, this is relative to the commons that you're talking about. As the human population has increased, various commons have been, had to have been abandoned in one aspect or another. For example, open farming that existed maybe during the westward expansion in the United States had to be curtailed for private farms. Open dumping of garbage into the woods behind your house might have been fine during colonial times, but as population grew, sewage systems and waste management were required. Finally, open airways in which people fly planes wherever they'd like to had to be managed through flight plans and managed flight paths so that planes wouldn't crash into each other as air travel grew. Many of these challenges of the tragedy of the commons are now only appearing because of the scale of the activities which we're now able to undertake. When there's only one fishing boat, there just isn't a problem. When there are thousands of floating fish factories, the situation has changed and we have a problem. Fortunately, information technology allows us to create more sophisticated and better managed approaches to regulating the commons. This includes the commons, even when the commons are themselves technology. So when we have some commons that is all about technology, like net neutrality, but it also means that technology can be applied to managed commons which aren't part of technology, you know, by themselves. Perhaps through the Internet of Things technology, perhaps through social organization, perhaps through administrative structures that support that. Some interesting places to look for these kinds of innovations include in highway traffic management and in wireless broadband management. Thank you very much.